Lord, you are worthy to be praised. We could be doing anything on a Friday night, but we came here together as a family. Hallelujah, Jesus. Please, yeah, I'm not even going to beg it. I'm going to tell you right now, guys. Y'all know the Holy Spirit is here. Amen. He says two or more are gathered in the midst. Amen. Look, we are not like traditional setups. Y'all know we super unconventional here. We are as close to the Bible. If you were on a deserted island and you read that word, and then you never seen church before, amen, or what you think church is, but you read that word and you stepped out, you would see that what you're seeing today is not really close to that word. This is actually more close. They were family. Do you know they just didn't meet up on Sundays? They met up every single day, practically. And you know they didn't meet up? In the church building. They met up in their homes. Now, I'm not knocking the building. You guys can take a seat. I'm not knocking the building. Amen? But what I'm trying to say here is that, authentically, Christ is dealing with people. I said it before and I'll say it again. He's not coming back for our 501c3s. He's not coming back for a building. He's not coming back for our organizations. He's coming back for his people, his ecclesia. Amen? Good to see you guys. Praise the Lord. I've never seen y'all before. Maybe y'all made a wrong turn. Who knows? But I feel in the spirit. She got the cross on, so maybe. Praise the Lord. They was just like, hold on, this ain't the spot. I thought we were supposed to be at Popeye's.
No.
Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. I want you guys to really focus on something here. You know, it's kind of interesting, this whole setup here, that this is like a couple days we're about to start opening up gifts and doing all that traditional stuff, right? That's what we're used to, amen? And the Lord started speaking to me about Christmas, and I was just like, I bet you everybody thinks we're going to do this whole nativity thing. We're going to have a play. You're going to have people with flags and everything, doing cartwheels and mimes. And it's just like, no, fam, we ain't doing all that. Amen? She liked that. That's because you was in color guard.
Yes, I was. Yeah, you're doing color guard.
Anyways, so, yeah, okay, y'all can girl out later. But, yeah, I mean, on God's watch here, though, reality is that none of that's really biblical, though. Now, we can do things as a form of expression. But, you know, Colossians 2 actually talks about they were having issues back in the day. I don't know if you guys understand. Most of the holidays that we celebrate, like, they have some type of, like, pagan roots to it, you know? And I'm not knocking the whole thing. I ain't the person to be like, oh, man, y'all want them churches that don't celebrate Christmas? No, actually, we celebrate Christ a lot more than you think, amen? And it's just not one day, amen? It's for the rest of our lives. See, if you really break that word down, Christ Mass. Anybody speak Espanol? Oh, yeah, yeah. Y'all do.
Christ more.
More of Christ. Amen? Amen?
Yes.
Okay. Is that what we see? Come on. Y'all know what we see? Ho, ho, ho. Mary. No. Ain't nothing Christ in that. God, the guy alone. I think he dropped. He forgot the N at the end of his name. Amen? They should restore that back. All right. And I'm going to hit there because we have to be biblical. Amen? I mean, if you think about it, like, yeah, I thought about that song, you know? Who knows if you're what? When you're sleeping. We all know it. Naughty or nice. I'm like, is Santa God? I mean, he knows our thoughts. He knows he's keeping a list and checking it twice. What? What are we talking about here? He's omnipresent? But then he got to slide down the chimney? We get some cookies? What's going on? Right? We gotta like elaborate stories for our children and all this stuff to make them feel kind of normalized. And then they find out, hey, he ain't real. Oh, I already knew. I seen you early in the morning. Because, you know, they'd be camping out trying to wait. See what's under the tree. Some of us did that. But this is what Christ is trying to say here. We have to think of what does it look like to have more Christ in your life, period. Not just one season, not just one day, not just, hey, this is just the season. God is saying in your totality for your life. What did Jesus really come here to do? Because I'm going to tell y'all here, and we're going to get straight to it, you know, for time's sake. But he's no longer in that manger, y'all. He's no longer in that manger. I know the manger is a beautiful thing. We got our little nativities. I know we probably got our house decorated certain ways. And it's a beautiful story. We keep going through it. But it's like consistently, we don't see the whole picture. The whole picture is that that same child, that same baby was born in a manger. Yes, he humbled himself and became a human to save humanity. But that's the point. Why? It said Jesus came to what? Save you from what? He said, Jesus, they said, we will name him Jesus, and he will save you from your sins, not for you to stay in them. See, you know something else is being preached. I know this is not on the airwaves, on everybody's radar. Christ is saying the very thing that you have a problem with, which is your sins, he came and died for them. He saves you from them, not for you to be wrapped up in them. We're thinking that God's grace, this is a gift to humanity, amen? We worried about gifts under the tree, but are you sharing the gospel with somebody? The real gift of eternal life. Because eternal life is not something you're going to. You inherit through Jesus Christ. Amen? He says eternal life is in the Son. No one else. Not Krishna, not Buddha, not Muhammad, nothing else. Not New Age, not Christ consciousness, not my inner self. No, that's still focusing on you. You know, we got them self-help books. I said it before and I'll say it again. People will go forward in motivational speeches, because that's what you're getting on Sundays most of the time. Mm-hmm. Motivational speeches, self-help, all this other stuff before what? Opening up this word. They'll go to that first, because this is what we do. When we look at this word, this is what we do. I'm going to read the Bible, right? We give it like 2.5 seconds, right? 2.5, maybe 30 seconds. This is what we do when we get home. We go, oh, yeah, read that word. Or we play it in our ears, and we'll be like, oh, the Lord and King Solomon. Gone. We'll be let out. Like, where I left at? You got through two sentences. You got through, like, maybe one verse. Got drool on it and everything. Amen? I know what be happening. Because here's the thing. You got to get rooted in Christ. You gotta have community. You gotta have people that are truly here to help you build in your faith. The Bible says your faith increased by what? Hearing the word of God. How can you hear the word of God unless a preacher be sent to you? You gotta hear it. You read it, but you gotta hear it. You gotta do all of it. Amen? Your body is not meant to, at least your spirit, man, can only survive off of this. Now we gonna eat later, amen? But we're going to talk about something, how to be fed spiritually. And Christ wants us to know the truth today. Amen? All right. Anybody, you guys have your word or have a phone? I want you to look up this. Titus. They like Titus. I ain't never went to Titus. I know. That's what we're trying to. I'm trying to get y'all in deeper waters. Amen? Y'all ain't going to drown. Trust me. We have to understand that the grace of God is not something to play with. Amen? Amen? This is something that God is looking at. I want you guys to go to Titus, and this is 2, chapter 2, and this is 11. Thank you, Lord. I want y'all to see this here, because it's going to open up a can of worms. When everyone's there, they can say amen. Amen? Okay. It says, for the grace of God has been revealed. Who's the grace of God? Christ Jesus coming to this earth, right? But did he stay here? Nope. It says, bringing what? Salvation to all people, meaning in he's given us all the opportunity to make a choice to say, are you going to be born again? Right? Not just play as a Sunday Christian or confessing Christian, because even Jesus said, many will confess in that day, Lord, Lord. And he's going to come at them and say, hey, I never knew you. Those that were workers of iniquity. Y'all know what iniquity means? That means hidden sin. That means your private life and your public life, they don't match. That means you're hiding something. You're operating and breaking God's law. Breaking God's law is sinning, y'all. See, we need to know the truth here, that God will give you the grace through his Spirit to live a set apart life, a holy life unto him. It is a process, amen? But don't believe that, hey, I'm just going to be the struggling sinner saved by grace. I'm going to tell y'all the truth about God's word, and then you're going to be accountable to either obeying it and doing it. Because a lot of us are hearers of God's word, but we don't actually obey it. God wants both out of your life. And this is what the word of God says. It says, the grace of God has been revealed, bringing salvation to people, to all people, 12, and we are instructed to turn from what? Godless living and sinful pleasures. What? So I can't just walk up in church and be like, okay, you know, and that's the thing. It ain't about walking up in church, y'all. You're the ecclesia. You are that church. The reason why we meet together is because we're not forsaking the assembly. That's what the word of God says. Because he's given different gifts. And when we come together, those gifts are being built up. You go from, literally, are they holding that baby there? Timothy can't jump in front of the car and be like, hey, man, I'm coasting. I'm gone. You know? He can't do that right now. We got to wait about 15 more years. Maybe even 18. That's the reality. You got to step by step grow spiritually. We all think we just come at this at the same level. No. God develops us. But he uses people. He uses his church, his ecclesia, his people to do that. Amen? That's why we're called to be disciples. And this is what he's saying. If you know that Christ has came to save you from your sins, then why are you still wrapped up in them? You understand? Like, I knew at this moment, when I share the testimony plenty of times. I've had friends of mine that literally almost got banned. They almost got discharged, literally, from the Navy. Because they drunk too much. They had an alcohol. They had a DUI. He called me. I prayed for him. Boom. They gave him grace, right? And he said, I'll never do it again. I'll never do it again. In my mind, I'm like, yeah, you probably won't do it again, man. You know? But once he knew the Lord and he started to find out, I talked to him about that. I said, you know, when I saw what the Lord did in your life, I started evaluating things in my own household. I was trying to figure out, like, why do I have shot glasses still? Why do I have all these things here? Why do I have Hennessy over here, this over there? And I knew immediately. I said, I'm grabbing this bottle and I'm throwing it away. I'm going to put some action into my practicing holiness. Amen? Yeah, y'all ain't hearing me. Amen? So y'all understand, it's not just saying it, it's actually doing something about it. It's saying that I don't need this anymore. Once I read that word and it said, be sober-minded, I was like, ooh, that means everything. That means I can't even intoxicate myself with anything, period. I mean, unless I'm going under the knife, then somebody got to inject me. I ain't trying to stay awake, amen? But what God is saying is that all of us that try to operate and say, hey, that's good, that comes from the earth. Y'all know what I'm talking about, right? You know? And then people are like, hey, but the Lord Jesus is saying, you come out of the dust out of the ground too, and your body is perishing. But I made you a new creation, a new creature from the inside out. And so now you live by my standards, not by the world. Amen? And this is what Jesus is trying to speak to us. He's saying, if you are truly married to Christ, if you are the body of Christ, you should be divorced from this world. You really should be. You should understand, like, hey, I'm dealing with a world that is borderline, I mean, just straight nutso, you know? And the Bible says that the wisdom of this world is not just sensual, right? It doesn't just, it appeals to our, what we see, what we hear, what we touch. It's all about the flesh, but it's also demonic. It says it's demonic. It says the wisdom of this world is earthly, sensual, and not or, demonic. Meaning in mankind and the demonic, in bed. Us adults know that. And I'm trying to tell you guys something today, that we have to really get a grip on how crazy this situation is and how he wants us as children of God to live. He doesn't want you just saying, hey, you know, I celebrate this and da da da. It's like, okay, but is this your life though? Is this your life? Because that's what it really needs to be. That's like, I remember years ago, going to quote unquote Easter Sunday, right? Then I found out that word meant, it comes from the root word Ishtar, which is a goddess of fertility,
That's why they paint the eggs and all that stuff. Actually, they used to dip it in blood and then sacrifice the children. All right? So it's some graphic stuff. That's the history of it. But we all like, I love cute Easter eggs, buddy. Right? That's not what it is. See, Satan comes as a what? Angel of light. He's going to disguise himself. He's going to look straight up legit in the world. But you got to look spiritually. You got to see this stuff. And you can't do it in your flesh. And you know how he gets us wrapped up? In our carnality, in sin. Primarily two areas, idolatry and sexual immorality. And the biggest thing that we're in fact, the Bible says to run from both of those things. It didn't say waltz, it didn't say do the two-step, it didn't say dance around it. It said run from sexual immorality. Run, like, ooh, it's getting hot, ooh, start running. You understand? It's saying idolatry as well. You know what idolatry is? Do you know that stubbornness is idolatry? You want to know why? Because when you're stubborn, you're actually serving yourself. You're idolizing yourself. You're saying, I want it my way or no way at all. And God is saying, it ain't about your way anymore. It's about his way. And he's going to put you to the test. He's going to let you know. But this is what I always tell people. Even if you're in that test, understand that God really wants you to pass it. Amen? He doesn't tempt us, but he allows things to happen. And a lot of stuff, I'm going to keep it a buck, is not everything is him. You have an enemy. And some of this stuff you put on yourself. You know you hard-headed. You know that, like, unforgiveness is a real thing. You got to deal with that. Jesus said, if you hold bitterness in, you know what happens? He said he hands you over to the tormentors. Who are the tormentors? This is something in the demonic. That's why I tell people, hey, bitterness and anger, these things you got to get rid of out of your life. Period, point blank. Christ forgave all mankind, so he says you must forgive one another. I don't care if it's within the body of Christ or even somebody outside, an unbeliever. It don't matter. You need to get that straight. Amen? And so when he's speaking about this here, he's trying to give us some insight. Titus, this is a man of God, and he's speaking from a place of admonishment, because Paul at this time so here's the thing about Paul. Paul was overseeing congregations, and he was appointing guys. Boom, boom, boom. Here. You be over this city, you be over that city. But he had to let them know. He said, look, I could paraphrase it. Y'all acting like a hot mess right now, and y'all to clean this up. That's what he was telling them. If you keep reading, especially Corinthians, he was like, this is the church. This is the hot mess church, okay? And it makes total sense, because they were in, like, Las Vegas 3.0. You understand? Not knocking off some of y'all from Vegas. But it was like literally, they are literally. But I'm just saying that it was crazy. They had, okay, the principality. Y'all understand this. We live in a spiritual world. Amen? You guys are bodies, but the Bible says we're made up of what? Body, soul, and spirit. Okay? Y'all get that. So what God does for the born again believer, in order to compete, to really actually deal with the spiritual things in this world, the power of darkness, you have to be rescued. You have to be rescued by the dear son, Jesus. You have to be born again of water and spirit. That's what Jesus said. That's why he said, hey, repent, for the kingdom of God is right here. How? Because the spirit of God was living through Jesus himself. And he was like, hey, I'm going to die. I'm going to die on the cross, save you from your sins, rise up, ascend to heaven, and now I'm going to send my Holy Spirit. And anyone that repents means to turn away, not turn towards your sin, turn away from your sins and turn to God, have a change of mind, and be baptized in the authority of Christ Jesus. Not symbolically, a spiritual reality happens when you go down in that water. The Bible says that your body is buried and you're united to Christ Jesus. And guess what? The power of sin is broken now. Hallelujah. So what happens is you become in Christ. So because Christ overcame sin, you get to overcome sin. Because Christ rose from the dead and overcame death because he was sinless, guess what? You get to get that too because of what he did. Amen? But his response, He wants you to put your faith and repentance in him. That's first. That's first. I don't just say, hey, just jump in the water. Boom. I say, no, 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 no. Do you have a change of mind? Do you have a change of heart? Do you really want God's desires? Do you really want to live for him now? You understand? Because when you get buried in that water, that's what it is. You're burying that body of sin. It's not washing dirt off. It's washing your conscience. You're like, I'm not shameful of any of this stuff in it. Those sins are in that water. I come up a new creation. The resurrection of Christ is what makes this thing effective. So when you become a part of this family, this born again family, now you can really compete. Because the Bible says that you will be filled with this Holy Spirit. Amen. And you literally, and that's why I ask people, it's like, you've been fully filled with the Spirit. You're going to be speaking in tongues. You're going to be prophesying. These things are going to start coming. You're going to have to push yourself. But there's things that, like, when you have that faith, that's what's going to happen. Amen? And so now you can really, really deal with the supernatural things. Because to be honest with you, dude, you ain't got, you, look, the Bible says, greater is he, the Holy Spirit, that lives within you. That's the only way you fight spiritually. You're not going to fight any other way. You fight in your flesh. First thing, if you fight in your flesh, you're not recognizing your true warfare. All right? Ephesians 6 says what? That we are not going against people, but what? Spiritual rulers in high places. Amen? And so these spiritual things are happening. And over that city of Corinth, guess what it was? The principality called Aphrodite. She was the goddess of what? You guys know Greek mythology? Y'all understand that? Okay, just I'm going to break it a little down. Basically, everything about pleasure, everything about sex, everything about that type of stuff. All right? And literally all about me, 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 me. That's the regional spirit or demonic entity that was over there. So the rest of them were struggling with that. And so he's telling them, hey, you guys are a hot mess, clean it up. And he's telling all the other churches the same thing. Now, what is Jesus telling you, though? What is Jesus telling you in your life that you need to clean up? What is Jesus saying, hey, this little corner area that you've been protecting, I want that. You understand? He said, trust in the Lord with all of your heart. Lean not to your own understanding. How many times are we really doing that? We think like every little decision that we make is 100% God. Not really. Do we acknowledge God in every single step? Some of us don't. But here's what God is saying. Let's look at the rest. He says we should live in this what? Evil world with wisdom, righteousness, and devotion to who? God. He says while we look forward with hope to that wonderful day when the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ, will be revealed. He gave his life to what? Free us. Everyone say freedom.
Freedom.
Freedom. He says free us from every kind of what? Every kind of what? Y'all still on there? Y'all see it? It says sin to cleanse us and to make us his very own people. Totally committed. Say, I am totally committed to doing good works. God is not saying we are saved by those works. He's saying, I called you for those works. And the cold part is that we're doing a lot of things that's opposite. Jesus wants to get our mind today. Look, this wasn't going to be no nativity stuff, all right? God told me straight up. He just said, hey, you got to be 100 with these people. Tell them that, hey, if you got anger, if you got bitterness, you got some things you want to let go, you got some families that you know, hey, I've been dealing with this for a minute, you know, and you're saying, I want to give this up to God. I need healing in this area, right? Not just physical healing, but there's some emotional healing that has to take place. Only Christ can do that, amen? Only Christ is the one that can get you in a place where, like we were saying in the singing earlier, he says he won't fail you. Everything else will fail you. I guarantee you that. You put your faith in other things, it will fail. It will crumble. You think that every single person is going to tell you the truth, it's not going to happen. The Bible says clearly, God is truth, and every man is a what? Liar.
Amen.
Okay? And your enemy is the biggest liar. He's the first to lie. Okay? But here's what Jesus came really to do. That baby ended up turning into what? A man. And that man was actually God in the flesh. You understand? And he dealt with our infirmities. He dealt with everything. He understood every single temptation we went through, but he never sinned. And so now, because of him being able to die on that cross and resurrect, and now we should be living a life where we're having more of Christ. And I tell you guys, and I'm going to wrap it up in a second. If you really have more of Christ in your life, you should really have less sin. Amen? Yep. You should really have a place where you're like, I don't used to sin like I used to sin. You understand? You see true transformation. And what I want to preach and tell you guys today is that the truth is you really overcame sin when you're in Christ Jesus. He breaks its power. You're not sinless. Amen? You're sin-free. You have the freedom not to. Amen? Please stand up. You have the freedom not to. I feel the Lord telling me here that specifically, there are some people that do know that they need some emotional healing, that they do know that they haven't really dealt with every single area of their life. And I always give it an opportunity for people to recognize that Christ should be more in your life. He shouldn't be just like, you know, just a little part of it. He shouldn't just be like, you know, honestly, that little closet that you throw him in, you know, when you're around certain people. Amen? And you know how it goes. Because God is trying to build you up from the inside out. That's what he's supposed to do. That's what the Holy Spirit does. He works from the inside out. He's not worried about all the superficial stuff. He's like, hey, if you want to be transparent, I'm going to be transparent with you. I'm going to let you know. This is just what it is. And so I want to share with you guys just a moment where God is trying to get us to be so authentic with him. I know we're going to go back and we're going to get into our gifts and we're going to get into our bags. And we're going to get into our Christmas spirit, whatever. But the Lord just told me, he said, they really need to have more of me all the time. Not some of the times, all the time. And so if you know in your life, you're like, hey, I really do want more of Christ. I want more of Christ. You know, I'm going to pray for y'all. Amen. And if someone actually needs some emotional healing, they need something going on, or if they're like, hey, you know, I'm ready to do God's way, not my way. If you're that person, I'm just going to ask you to come up front. If you need prayer for anything, we don't announce it to the whole world, but I can tell you right now, we are in a spirit-filled church. Y'all know I don't play. I want to make sure that everybody here is cool, you know, in their heart, in their mind, in their soul, that they're well. Amen? I'm going to bring up something here. This was a little bit more of a special day. Some of us here, we know each other. We just finding out about folks here. Sister Samantha, right? Okay, praise God. All right. I was just like, ooh, don't let me get wrong. So she'd be like, yeah, we ain't going back. So, you know, the reality is this. Like, we are so, the Lord told me to do the Lord's Supper. I don't know if you guys know that. You know, we call it communion, but the reality is it's called the Lord's Supper, all right? We acknowledge that of his death and his burial, his resurrection, where we're taking his blood. Now, I'm going to tell you guys, I don't force this on nobody. You want to know why? Because the Apostle Paul didn't either. In fact, he corrected him. He said, don't take this body and put it this way. If you hungry, because we got food, amen? But don't go trying to do this like, oh, I'm trying to starve, oh, you know, hungry hippo over here. We're not doing that. God is saying, when you take this, understand that he broke his body for you. You understand? He bled for you, not for you to throw this grace back in his face. Amen? God wants to make sure that you recognize that. And so we're going to take the Lord's Supper. For some of you guys, and if you're born again, you know, I'm going to tell y'all right now, you guys know you're connected to this ministry, then hey, I would like you guys to take it. But here's the thing. Paul said to make sure that you write here. To make sure that you got any unforgiveness, any bitterness towards people, it's got to go. You know what I mean? You got to come straight right now. You know? You want to make sure. And for the kids, hey, I'm just going to keep going. I don't really push it on the kids like that. All right? Because they just, you know, if they get it, they get it. You know? But if they don't get it, we just leave it alone. All right? So 1 Corinthians chapter 11 says this, that you got to come to this situation correct. You can't come to the Lord's table and then drink of what? The cup of demons. Okay? And so I know we're a part of a lot of different things, but the Holy Spirit is saying he wants you to drink from this cup now. You understand? And what he means by that is what he has for your life. Because your real life is really in Christ. It's not in anything else. It's not in the career. It's not in the job. It's not in the studies. It's not in none of that stuff. That stuff is cool. To be honest with you, the stuff that you're doing right now, they're just vehicles. Vehicles change, right? But your relationship with Christ should not. It should be building up. You understand? You should be closer and closer, having more of Christ each and every day of your life. So you can look back years from now and go, whew. Like for me, 16-something years in the faith, born again. I look back and I'm like, whoa, I am not that same dude anymore. And I'm really grateful because I have plenty of times I know. So I want you guys to recognize that. If anyone does need prayer for anything, please come up. If you like, oh, no, I don't want, come on. And I want everybody here to recognize something. Born again, you a believer? I want everybody here. If you, if anyone else wants prayer, at least if you just like, hey, I want your way, God. I want more of you. We can pray for you. But specifically, we want to make sure that that gets dealt with. And if you do decide to want to take communion or take the Lord's Supper, we can do that right before, all right? So if there's no one else that needs prayer for anything, I'm just going to pray everybody out. If you want to talk later about things, especially becoming born again, or if you're praying and prophesying, or you want to know more about this ministry, discipleship, we really do that here, all right? Okay, let's look to the Lord. Dear Lord, we thank you again for your grace and for your mercy, Lord. Lord, I pray for your power, your protection, and your presence to be with every single person here, Lord. Lord, work on our hearts today, Lord Jesus, that we receive the good news, Lord, and we walk forward in our destiny, Lord. You call us to be conformed to the image of your Son, Lord, before the foundations of the world, Lord. So I ask that your grace, Lord Jesus, be with us, Lord, in all that we do and all that we say. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Give the Lord some praise. Hallelujah. We're going to start over here, and we got a lot of food, too, to eat. But I want you guys, if you are going to take communion, I want you guys to keep that in your mind, all right? So if you want to grab your own setup, you can do that right now, and I'll pray a blessing over it, and then we'll be out of here, and we'll get to food. So, amen. You guys could help yourselves. We're not coming up in the front. I don't got no little crackers. We actually got flatbread bread. That's like straight up as close as it is. You know, we didn't get no wine here. Amen. Because I know people will try to sneak. Say, you didn't bring no wine? No. We ain't doing that here. Good to see you guys. I know I feel like I'm like, y'all look super familiar. Y'all from out here?
No, I'm from out here.
You're from out here?
Yeah.
What part?
Mira Mesa.
Mira Mesa,
yeah.
Okay. He looked like somebody that I knew from way back. But I'm from the Bay Area.
Oh,
he looked like somebody literally like I grew up with.
I used to live out there in Monterey for a little bit.
Monterey, okay.
Yeah.
Alright. That's where we used to go to Gilroy Outlets. We're from the Bay. Yeah, we know that whole spot.
Stay here.
Yeah.
Get over here now.
Yeah. Let's take it. If you guys wanna take it and you got everything right, y'all ain't got no unforgiveness toward people. Amen. All right. So y'all can grab it. Somebody grab me one. Amen.
There's only two left.
There's only two left? They already ate them all?
Two left. What's that?
Oh, yeah.
All right.
I
like
that, too.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you. I'm not going to eat it yet.
Yeah. When everybody has it, please come. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. All right, guys, wait to eat. Wait. All right. Maybe, you got it?
Yeah.
Just a minute? Okay, all right. Okay, I want you guys, this is the body of Christ. Amen?
Amen.
He broke his body. He shed his blood for us. This is what we consume. We understand that Christ really did this thing. This is more of Christ in our life right now. We're going to take the body of Christ. All right, a blessing in Jesus' name. You can receive it. His blood, the Bible says that there's no remission of sins without the blood. Alright? Once and for all. There is no other Christ coming back. There's no more bulls. There's no more lambs. Nothing else. It's just his blood. Amen? This blood washes us clean. When we're baptized into Christ, it's only because of his sacrifice and his atonement of sins through his blood. And we understand that we have no remission without it. Amen? So we take his blood right now in Jesus' name. I don't pray a blessing over you. Everyone that received the Lord's Supper today, Lord, bless them abundantly, Lord Jesus, that they've acknowledged you in all their ways, Lord, that they really have more of Christ. Lord, be with them, Lord Jesus, as they travel. Lord, I pray for fellowship and new opportunities today, Lord. I pray for new communities to be shifted in the name of Jesus. That people operate in your true power.
Now we can go eat, Lord.
Bless
Jesus.
In Jesus' name. All right, love y'all.